Hey everybody, Josh Tully here. What you're about to listen to is an interview that I did on my radio show. So while we're on YouTube, I understand there's no actual video that you're about to see, but what you're about to hear is a completely different story. What you're about to hear is going to provide you with a lot of information that a lot of people have never heard before. And because of the response we got from the radio show, I wanted to put it out on YouTube as well. So here it is. Enjoy.
Transmission begins.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
This is the Josh Tully Show on the GCN Radio Network.
We're talking to Alexander Lawrence. He's the author of Leviathan's Ruse, Volume 1, The Comprehensive Guide Between the Battle of Good and Evil. Before we took that break, I was talking a little bit about, you know, getting some more specific detail here. And in the title, Leviathan's Ruse, a lot of people have never heard of that word. However, it's one I think they should hear of and understand. Who, what, how is Leviathan?
Well, Leviathan is this amazing sea serpent. It's a dinosaur, really, and it's the greatest creature that God ever created, right alongside to Behemoth. The book of Job talks about Leviathan and Behemoth, describes them, and the descriptions are really awesome. Basically, what this is a dragon that lived in the sea. And we don't see them around now. You know, you could say that they're extinct. There are other scriptures that seem to indicate that there are at least a few or one left somewhere. But this thing lived in the deep, and it was a terror any time that it came up and got around men. There was no way that anybody was ever going to take one of these things down, and so God brags about it and says how awesome it is. However, it's more than just that, because the scriptures use Leviathan a few times to describe something else, and that something else is this angelic entity that is high above everything else. So at the end of this description of this earthly creature, and it makes it very clear that it is an earthly creature in the book of Job, it says, he sees everything that is on high. He is the foremost among the sons of pride. And so it really throws you for a loop when you're reading that description, because you think you're reading about this animal, and then all of a sudden you're reading something that sounds like it's about Satan, because the sons of pride or the sons of rebellion are the fallen angels. And Leviathan, the sea creature, certainly doesn't see everything that is on high. So we know immediately from that there's something interesting going on with this creature. And then we go to verses like Isaiah 27:1, which is an eschatological verse, or it's talking about what's happening in the end times. And that verse says that in the day of the Lord, which is the day when Yeshua returns, that with his great and strong sword, God is going to punish that serpent, that crooked Leviathan, and he's going to slay that dragon that is in the sea. So he's using an earthly creature to talk about a heavenly creature, and I believe that is Satan, who is many, many times depicted as a serpent in different scriptures, but also in ancient accounts. They would talk about their gods in the ancient world as being serpents quite often. In fact, Zeus, the king of the gods in the Greco-Roman pantheon, he was depicted as a serpent in many places, many statues throughout the world.
Wow. So how does this relate then to the battle of good and evil? I mean, how does this play out in our world today?
That is a long answer, and there's a lot that goes into it, but I'll try to summarize it by saying that Leviathan is the encircling cherub. And in the book of Ezekiel, we see him described as this first and greatest creation, Satan, that is, the dragon. And he sort of encircles everything. He sums it all up, and there's a study in that in itself in the book. But he had great, great influence. And so when he rebelled against God, and in his pride, he decided that he could do it better than God could in terms of running this universe. He was able to convince many of the angels that are high up in the hierarchy, that they also should rebel. And so we have a description that's somewhat masked in the scriptures. You have to really look for it, but it is there. We see this description of what we call the divine council of 70 angels that that God actually goes into council with, and they are involved in making the decisions about how to run the universe. Well, this council basically entered into what I like to call the first class action lawsuit. So they joined Satan in rebelling against God and saying, no, this is not right. This can't be right. I think because they had seen not only what happened in the garden with the fall of mankind and then the corruption of the world and God having to hit the reset button and flood the entire world to start it over, but then they also saw what happened to the Tower of Babel, because only a couple or a few hundred years after the flood, men were already descending into polytheism and war and all this stuff that came from the watchers, from the knowledge before the flood, that was displeasing to God. And so seeing all of this, I think they probably decided, you aren't going about this the right way, and we can do better. We can get these people in line. And so they entered into this lawsuit against God, and God allowed them to have their day in court, basically. So right now we're in that period where these angels, which the Greeks called the cosmocrators, okay, the cosmic powers, they are being allowed to rule over the nations of mankind, except for those who are in the kingdom of God. So there's many kingdoms of cosmocrators. There's only one kingdom of God, and it's basically one on 70, but that's okay because God's still going to win. And and so we're seeing this battle unfold, and it's a legal battle, but of course it also becomes this literal battle of the angels against one another, as we see in the book of Revelation, where in Revelation chapter 12, there is a war in heaven, and Michael actually kicks Satan and his angels out of heaven, and they have to come down to earth. That hasn't happened yet, in my opinion, but it will happen in the near future.
You know, it's interesting that you bring up the lawsuit against God. When we see in the New Testament Jesus talking about spiritual warfare, a lot of believers go to the full armor of God, you know, the breastplate, the sword, but when Yeshua Jesus talks about it, every time it's in the context of a court. It's not, you know, chop off their head, you know, shoot them in the leg. It's a court. So I think you are touching on a very large missed truth when it comes to how God's systems work. So thank you for that.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, that's the best way to understand it. It really is. And in fact, a lot of language related to God's way of doing things is legal in nature. So when it talks about the judgment of every person at the end of the world, Daniel, the book of Daniel, literally says books are opened, the court is seated, and people are brought before the judge. And like any earthly judge, he goes through the list of offenses, and then, you know, you have your chance to present your case, and all the good stuff is brought out too, and there's a judgment made. So, yeah, there's a lot of language like that in the Bible.
Yeah, and it actually, if people think about it, it actually allows them to understand things like, well, why did God allow this to happen? You know, we have a tendency to over-emotionalize this. But in reality, it's a legal case. It's if-then sort of decision-making.
Yes, and it has to play out because God is good. And he isn't the type of God to just put the hammer down and say, no, guys, it's my way or the highway. Although he could do that, he chooses not to because of love. So what he is saying is, I'm going to let you try it. See if you can do a better job than I do, and if you can solve this problem. And if you can't, then you're going to pay the penalty. But I'm willing, and also God has no, he has no problem with self-confidence. So he's able to say, look, I have no problem with you giving it a shot and questioning me, but I'm telling you right now, you're not going to be able to do it. And when we look in the Psalms, there's a very interesting psalm where it talks about the divine council being seated, and God scoffs at them and says, How long are you going to allow this stuff to go on? How long are you going to allow injustice and oppression and let the weak be trodden over? He says, you guys had no idea what you were getting into. Of course, I'm paraphrasing, but basically that's what the language comes down to. He's saying,
sir, hold on. Hold on one second because we're up against a break again. Hold on. We'll keep digging right after this. All right, we're talking to Alexander Lawrence, his book, Leviathan's Ruse. So what's the ruse part of this? And we talked about what Leviathan is. We talked about how it's not only possibly an earthly creature, but there's a spiritual component, kind of like, and that's not uncommon in the Bible. You know, you have the king of Persia. They weren't actually talking about Persia. So what's the ruse aspect?
Sure. Well, let me pause real quick and just say something I wanted to say before break about the cosmic creators and Leviathan. Just something to encourage people, because throughout the ancient world and in the Bible, the fallen angels are depicted as serpents, oftentimes serpents with wings, or what we would consider to be dragons. And then there's another type of unclean spirit or fallen spirit that are demons, and they are depicted in a different way in the Bible. They're called scorpions. And so that symbology is important to understand when we look at the words of Yeshua, and he told his disciples that we have been given power to tread on serpents and scorpions. We see this also in the constellations, by the way. So this is written in the scriptures, it's written in the sky, and we need to not misinterpret verses like that by taking them, you know, ultra literally, because it is figurative. But he is telling us that we as disciples have power over these entities. So it's not just the demons, the unclean spirits that came from the Nephilim that plague people on earth, you know, in a variety of ways. It's not just them that we can exercise authority over, but we've been given authority even over the cosmic creators. You know, that's a different level of warfare, spiritual warfare. But Yeshua made it very clear, serpents and scorpions, there's a distinction, but we have authority over both. So if you're a disciple, you are actually supposed to be waging a battle and treading over these guys. And any time a cosmic creator sees you coming into his territory, he should be afraid because you're carrying the light of Yeshua.
Amen to that.
Now, so there's a plan. You know, Satan's not going into this thing without, he's brilliant. He's the first creature ever created, you know, the first thing that Yeshua ever made before even the rest of the universe and the rest of the angels. So we can't underestimate how absolutely capable he is in terms of strategy. And he has been strategizing for all of human history, because he doesn't die. He's not like a human being. He can just keep building one block on to the next from generation to generation. And so what I've tried to show is that what happens in the end times is not just in the end times. The groundwork for this was laid in the beginning and has been continued throughout. So in the book, I talk a lot about the occult and the mystery religions and the mystery schools throughout history and what their agenda is and what they have been doing, mostly behind the scenes, to affect human history and to blind us all to what's going on. Because they're the puppets, and the puppeteers are Leviathan and the cosmic creators. And so there's a lot that goes into that. There's a lot of components to the ruse, but I try to break it into six major components, the first of which is
no worries.
We have misinterpreted Bible prophecy in some ways, and understanding the prophecies properly in their Hebrew, their original Hebrew context, and also in relation to the divine appointed days of God is very important if we're going to understand what really the prophetic scriptures are telling us about the end times. And unfortunately, because of the influence of the Gentiles in the church from an early time, we've really lost a lot of the context that we need to be able to properly interpret the scriptures. Now, thankfully, that is starting to come back into the limelight. There's been a lot of, just a surge of increased interest in what the Tanakh or the Old Testament has to say and the groundwork that it lays. But if we properly understand these things, then we won't be tricked into believing, you know, that this one thing over here that dispensationalist teachers are saying is going to happen is going to happen, and then it doesn't. But then we're not prepared for this other event over here. One of those things that I emphasize in the book is there is going to be a dark resurrection, and most Christians have no idea. So they think that the Antichrist, when he shows up, is going to be killed by a head wound. It doesn't say that in Revelation. It says one of the heads of the beast, which is figurative, is going to be wounded unto death. It doesn't say the Antichrist receives a head wound and then he's resurrected. It does say there's a resurrection, though. It says one of these heads, which are these rulers, was in the past, now at the time of John is not. In other words, he's not living at that time, but he will be again in the future. So it is telling us there's a resurrection. And this is like the Antichrist or the false Christ mimicking the real one. But what I try to show is that this person has already lived. Satan has already used him. He was already the greatest king of Babylon, the greatest king that ever lived. And he will be returning again in the end times. So we're completely unprepared for this dark resurrection to happen, which is why the whole world, Revelation says, will wonder after this beast. And yet we're looking for a pre-tribulation rapture, which the Bible does not teach. Sorry to anybody out there who's a preacher rapture theorist, but you know, I spend a whole chapter talking about how that is not the case. And we're actually, the resurrection takes place at the second coming of Messiah, at the end of the tribulation, just as Yeshua said in the Olivet Discourse. It's after the tribulation that all occurs. And so we're looking for one thing and we're going to get hit with another, and it's really going to cause a lot of falling away in the church, I'm afraid.
Well, I want to talk about the rapture, because that is a very common Christian thing. It's almost like, you know, their version of the Super Bowl in a sense. But let's back up a little bit to this he once was but wasn't and will be again sort of idea. A lot of people have said that that's kind of depicting the Roman Empire as a whole, not an individual, because Rome fell, but it went over to Constantinople, became the Byzantine Empire, and it never really died, and that's going to rise again. And some people are thinking, well, wait a second, is that what Turkey's now trying to do? Are you saying it's an actual person, or could it possibly be that sort of nation state through Rome, through Istanbul sort of issue?
No, it's an actual person. So the different heads of the beast are said to be kings. They're also, the angel says, they're also hills. So they're figurative for two things at the same time. And, you know, that's a long discussion as to why they're hills. But they are certainly kings, not nations as a whole. Now, kings have kingdoms. But the reason that we know that this is not just a kingdom is because it says that this beast comes up out of the abyss, and the whole world wonders after him, and he speaks mighty things. I mean, it talks about him as a person who is going to be doing signs and wonders and leading the whole world astray, the man of lawlessness. And what I do in the book is go back to the Old Testament prophecies, and I show where he shows up in a number of places. In fact, he's named. And I have to give credit to Peter Goodgame for this, because he turned me on to this idea. But the scripture actually names him as Asher. And it blew my mind when I realized that, in fact, the Bible is talking about Asher, and it's the name of the Antichrist. And I just had never seen it. But one of the main reasons that nobody has, or few people have really recognized this, is because that word Asher can be translated as Assyrians, plural, or a the Assyrian, or it can be the name Asher, depending on the context. But in the Hebrew language, you don't know that unless you're really aware of that possibility and the context of it. So we don't get it in the English. But
that is
oftentimes
that is amazing. I've never heard that. So if that's the case, is there context or reason to believe that this Asher character, whether it's Assyrians plural or the individual, is going to make a return to the scene, and if so, when? And keep in mind, you have less than a minute, so we might have to carry this over to the next segment.
Okay, sure. Yes, so Asher is Let me just say, the occult has been aware of this and planning on bringing him back for thousands of years. And so I dedicate chapters in the book to showing that that is the case, and they know it, and they're looking forward to that day that he can be brought back.
Oh, my goodness. Man, everybody's going to be on the edge of their seats. Everybody stay where you're at. Wow. We are going down this rabbit hole right after this. Don't go anywhere, folks. All right. So welcome back. Second hour, Josh Tully Show, GCN Radio Network. You already know the website, joshtully.com. You already know to get my book, Evangelpreneur. But I want to get right back to it because we are talking about something that has got so many people on the edge of their seats. Have a listener in San Diego saying, oh my gosh, this is more exciting than X-Files. Well, of course it is, because this is biblical. X-Files is just whatever. But we are talking to Alexander Lawrence. He is the author of Leviathan's Ruse, Volume 1, the comprehensive guide to the battle between good and evil. And before the break, sir, you identified the Antichrist, saying it is Asher. We want to dig into that a little bit. But some of the other things I want to talk about is you mentioned the occult activity in the past trying to resurrect this dude, this dark resurrection, and also this idea behind the pre-trib rapture. But let's get back to the Asher character, if you could, and expand on that a little bit. So you're saying this is an actual guy who's going to be resurrected, and they've been trying to resurrect him?
Correct. I don't know how much the attempts have gone forward yet, but that is actually something interesting for us to talk about, because right now as we speak, the lead-in to the sign of Revelation 12, the cosmic sign in the heavens, is happening. It started at Christmas or Hanukkah, and in September, the September 23rd, the sign of the woman giving birth is actually going to appear for only the second time in history. And that has, to, in my opinion, it has to do with the Antichrist, so we might want to talk about that a little bit. But so let me lay a little groundwork before I kind of explain more about Asher.
Sure.
So, yeah, the cosmic creators, they are trying a number of different things. They're experimenting to try and get us to a state of utopia. Cosmic creators are experimenting in different ways to get us back to utopia, or a state of being like gods, and prove that they can handle us better than Yahweh can. But Satan, they have not admitted yet something that Satan already knows, which is that this kind of utopian society will never work unless you have a quote-unquote enlightened dictator at the top. And this is in agreement with Yahweh, because he's going to install his Messiah, Yeshua, at the top of everything, and he will be the king over the whole earth. The scripture says that during the millennium, he will rule the nations with a rod of iron. Satan gets this, and he says, okay, I'll put my man in place instead. But the cosmic creators, I don't think they're quite on that page yet, and they're still trying to do things in their different ways. If you look on the back of our dollar bill, for instance, you see Novus Ordo Seclorum. That's new secular order. And what that is telling us, it's them broadcasting that they are trying a new experiment, and the Western world today is a secular experiment in getting us to this evolved state where they can create a utopia. That is failing right now. And so, as everything else has failed to this point, we keep having wars, nations keep falling, and then they reconstruct Babylon or Egypt in some other way, in some other place. Well, we're getting to that point, very close to that time, when they're going to say, okay, we're going to let you do it your way, and they hand over their power to Satan's man. So Genesis says that there's a seed of Satan, just like there's the seed of the woman, which was Yeshua, the New Testament tells us. Well, Satan has his seed, and that's Asher. And Asher was at one point at the top of the world. But the cosmic creators didn't like that. If you look in Ezekiel chapter 31, there's a long allegory about Asher. It actually names him and says, Asher was this giant tree. He was over the entire world. He was the biggest tree that's ever been, and everything was under his branches. He was the king of the whole world in the time shortly after the fall of Babel. But the cosmic creators were jealous of it. They're described as trees in this allegory. They're trees in the garden of God. And it says several times, trees in the garden of God. And so it's talking about spiritual beings. And they got jealous, and they told God, look, this guy is incredibly prideful. You need to bring him down. And God assented to that and said, okay. So he sends in the terrible ones of the nations, which I believe were giants at the time, and they kill him. And he goes down to Sheol. So he is there now. Well, the book of Revelation says that this guy, the beast, Asher, comes up out of the abyss in the end times, and he is the last king of the world. So he was the first king of Babylon, and he'll be the last king of Babylon. Wow. So that sort of sets the stage for what's going on, but the book of Revelation also tells us that the kings that are ruling the world at the time of the beast's return will assent to give over their power to the beast in the end times. So that's when the cosmic creators say, okay, we're going to do it your way, and assent to the Leviathan having his man at the top of everything. Now, the occult religions...
Oh, go ahead. Just a real quick question for clarification purposes. You keep saying cosmo creators, and I'm assuming that that's going to be a term that's new to a lot of listeners. What do you mean by that?
So the cosmo creators are the 70 members of the Divine Council. They are the highest order of angels. And okay. Psalm 82, I believe it is, talks about them, but you'll find them in a number of different scriptures. Psalm 82 is a really good one to go to see that. Michael Heiser, Dr. Michael Heiser, talks about them in his work quite a bit, and he really hits the nail on the head, so I would say refer to his work if you want to know more about that.
Okay. So keep going. I didn't want to interrupt you. I just wanted to get some context for listeners.
No, that's good. So the religions... I call them occult religions, but they're mystery religions and they're mystery fraternities throughout history. They know that this king has been put away and that he's going to return. And let me give you an example of that. So the Freemasons, when they initiate someone to become a master mason, they talk to him as if the great architect of the universe, or what they call God, is speaking to the master mason. And this is what this God says. This is a quote. Seek ye the grave of Hiram, that's their name for this Asher character, the grave of Hiram, who has carried my will with him to the tomb. This eternal quest is yours until you have found your builder. No more shall I speak until you have found and raised my beloved son. And I have listened to the words of my messenger, and you have listened to the words of my messenger, and with him as your guide have finished the temple, which I shall then inhabit. Amen. End quote. So they understand that there is this very important character that has gone to the grave. He has gone to Sheol, just like Ezekiel 31 tells us. But that they need to bring him back. And this is not just the Freemasons. It goes to all the secret societies. They try to get there in different ways, but they're all sort of aiming for the same goal. So they have two goals. One, to bring us to a utopia, at least a utopia for the elites. And then number two, to bring back the world dictator who is supposedly enlightened. And so let me talk a little bit about who he was.
Yeah.
Asher... In Genesis chapter 10, we see that, and I think he was actually Nimrod, so I try to argue that in the book, but even if he's not, he was around the same time, he was a contemporary. But after talking about Nimrod and him establishing the beginnings of this kingdom of Babel, it says that Asher, because Nimrod is a title, it means let us rebel. I think Asher was his real name, and Asher goes north from southern Mesopotamia into northern Mesopotamia, or what became the Akkadian area, and he establishes a bunch of cities there, and then he starts to move northwest, establishing great cities and walled cities and these, you know, things that hadn't been seen at that point since before the flood.
Well, hold on one second. Man, there's so many different directions we could go here. Who gave them the tech to build the... Anyway, we'll dig into more of this. Stay where you're at, folks. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back right after this. All right, we are talking with Alexander Lawrence, the author of Leviathan's Ruse. You got to grab a copy of this because I can already tell we are not going to have enough time to cover everything in this show. But, sir, I want you to talk about where we left off. But real quickly, a couple questions had come in, and they're consistent, so I want to make sure that we clarify this. And those 70 members of the Divine Council, are those good guys or are those Satan's fallen angels?
Well, initially they were good, but then they fell. It was after Satan fell, because Satan was already a rebel at the time of Adam and Eve being in the garden. But the cosmic craters don't seem to fall until later, after the Tower of Babel. And then they get jealous of Asher, and it says that they petition God to bring him down, and then God rebukes them and basically says you're gonna go down to the grave like a man would, even though you're a god. And so I believe their rebellion was later on, but initially they were good and they were working with God. And we see in places like Job that God still holds counsel, and Satan, the dragon, still comes before him, and that I think that would include the rest of the members of the divine council are still coming before God and convincing him of things, trying to convince him of things, bringing accusations against the believers like he did against Job and that sort of thing.
Right. Okay. Cool. So let's get back to this. These cults, whether they're Masons or secular humanists or whatever they happen to be, they're all trying different ways to revive and bring up this Asher character. And you think this is going to be by 2060 at the latest or thereabouts? What should we be looking out for? I mean, how can we see this coming?
Well, it's a little hard to see it coming, but the technology, now this could be done through some sort of arcane arts that I don't understand, don't know about, don't want to know about, so that's possible. But it's interesting to me that technology is now at the point where we can actually literally resurrect people. In fact, there was an article not very long ago about an Italian poet who had, and not to get crass, but some of his bodily fluids were found to still be intact in a piece of handkerchief. And scientists were confident that they could extract the DNA from that handkerchief and actually clone this person. They could bring him back, even though he lived decades and decades ago, because they had his complete genome available to them. Well, wow. If we can do that, then it's possible, if we could get DNA from even further back, that we could resurrect by regrowing someone who lived in the ancient past. And I think the Egyptians were looking forward to exactly that. So let me try to tie some things together to get there. Asher goes up building, and by the way, the Freemasons believe that their art of masonry, of building, and when we look in the ancient world, we see incredible structures with masonry techniques that we can't duplicate, have no idea how to do even now, and these buildings are around the world. So they had advanced technology related to architecture. Well, the Freemasons say that that masonry goes back to Nimrod, and he was the first one to start teaching these advanced techniques to people, and not only building things physically and literally in the world, but also he was teaching the building of a greater society, and he was teaching how to become enlightened people and how to advance spiritually and these sorts of things. So they look back to him. I think that was Asher. And Asher moves north and west up, the Fertile Crescent, building these great cities. Then he ends up over in the Levant, in the region of Lebanon and Syria and Israel. And it's interesting because the name Asher became Tyre over there in what is now Lebanon. The name Asher means strong and unyielding, whereas Tyre means rock. And the name Tyre comes from the Semitic Sur. In Arabic, it's Sur. In Babylonian, it's Suru. But that means rock, and so it's the root sound in Asher. And Tyre became the hub of everything that we see related to the Babylonian polytheistic religion, and it was kind of one of the centers of the ancient world. Then Asher continues to migrate down to Egypt, and he goes into Egypt and becomes the first king of Egypt and unites that land. There were many tribes there at that time, and he brings them all together. Are you familiar, Josh, with the god of Egypt named Osiris?
Yes.
Okay, do you remember what the story is behind him?
And the connection with his mother?
He had a sister, Isis.
Yeah.
I don't think there's anything about his mother.
Okay.
But his sister is the Egyptian version of the Mesopotamian goddess, which is, she goes by various names. There's lots of names around these people because after Babel, there were lots of languages. And so, you know, one person could go by many different names in different places. But she
but
was
didn't,
this goddess.
Didn't Osiris's mother have this, like the beginnings of that mother-son cult?
So Osiris and Isis had a son named Horus. And Horus, you always see him depicted as sitting on the lap of Isis. And he is, there's a lot of sun worship around Osiris and Isis, and that has been linked to worship of some of the other mother and son type of cults in the Near East.
Gotcha.
So I know where you're coming from there.
Okay.
But basically, in different places in the Near East, there was this sister who was a wife of this great demigod. In Mesopotamia, it was Inanna and Dumuzi. In Akkadia, slightly north of there, it was Ishtar and Tammuz. And then you move over into the Levant, and you find Baal, and I forget the name of his sister wife. But yeah, the same motif exists in all these places because it was the same story that just got carried over and slightly changed. And in all of these, we see there's a story about the dying and returning God. And this is symbolized with an annual celebration of the death of vegetation and the return of the vegetation. And also with the sun, because the sun dies throughout the year. You know, we see it going through the different seasons, and it gets shorter and shorter, and it dies on the winter solstice, and then it returns later in the year in its power. And then also every day it goes down from being highest power at noon to dying as it goes under the horizon and into the underworld. And so the Egyptians had the same story, and they linked this with Osiris and then with Horus, his son. And I explain in the book who Horus is and who Isis is, you know, what this represents, because Isis was based on a real person, as was Osiris, but Horus is figurative. He's symbolic of something. Anyway, so interestingly, the name Osiris is actually the same as Asher, because in the Egyptian, it's Aser. Only the Greeks changed it to Osiris.
So see, hold on one second. We're up against a break. We're up against a break. Okay. What's so fascinating about this is, like you said, people think there's all these different religions. There's really only two, and they give them different names. But that's why we see movies like The Mummy, where they try to resurrect these gods. And then we see it again in other cultures, too. Man, this is fascinating. Stay where you're at, folks. We'll be back right after this. Man, this topic is deep. You got to get the book, Leviathan's Ruse. Volume 1. That's how deep this is. Volume 1. We're talking to the author, Alexander Lawrence. Now, sir, let's kind of jump a little bit, staying related, but jump a little bit to this idea of the rapture, because I think that's interesting that we have all these demigods trying to become resurrected, this Asher character, you know, trying to be brought up and reign and rule over the earth. But then there's this resurrection or the rapture story that before all this bad stuff hits the fan, all the believers are just poof, out of here, gone. You're taking a different perspective on that, correct?
Correct. Really, you cannot find anything in the scriptures that says that the rapture takes place 7 or more years before the end of the age. So I'm taking a different look at that and saying it happens before the bowls of wrath are poured out at the very end of the age, just as there were 40 days of flooding at the time of Noah, there will be 40 days of the bowls of wrath flooding the earth, figuratively. And it's not until right before that happens that the people of God are gathered up. There's two harvests. There's the harvest of the wheat, which are those who are in the kingdom of God, and then the harvest of the grapes of wrath, and those happen back-to-back, but the wheat is gathered first. And so I spend a chapter in the book talking about all the different reasons, looking at the Moedim, which are the divine appointment days, the holy days of God each year, and how those relate to the timing of not only end time events, but also the rapture or the resurrection. Let me step back for a second, though. I want to tell you something about Osiris, because we were talking about Ashur, who became Osiris in Egypt.
Yeah.
Osiris was the first mummy. He was the initial king who became a mummy in early Egyptian history. And there's a very interesting passage in the pyramid texts, which talk a lot about Osiris and Isis. But this one particular text says that the Egyptians, when Osiris died, when he was killed, that they preserved his efflux under Giza, under the plateau of Giza in Egypt. Now, efflux means bodily fluid. That could be blood, could be semen. I think it's the latter, because that contains the complete genome. And how better to preserve somebody so they can be resurrected later than to keep that fluid? And it says that they actually sealed it in a hermetically sealed container under Giza, and that it's protected by some kind of fire. So I don't know if somebody has already found this, but if and when they do, that opens the gate to him returning. Do you remember a few years ago when Egyptologists said that they found the tomb of Osiris?
Yes.
Yeah, so they got down there, and they found this casket surrounded by a moat and a few pillars that they couldn't read what was on the pillars anymore, but the casket was giant. It was bigger than a normal person would need. Well, Osiris was said to be a giant, and Nimrod in the Bible is said to have been a giant. It says he became a Giborim, a mighty one, and that's also translated in the Septuagint as giant. And there's other ancient texts that attribute this to that character, this giantism. And so they found this casket, but it was empty. And that makes me go, because how do we know whether or not it was really empty, or whether they got down there, understood what they had found, and emptied it out before they brought the cameras down?
Yeah, that's exactly it. Yeah, take it out and say, oh yeah, nothing here, don't pay no attention.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't know if they have it yet or not, but I think it's quite possible. And one of the reasons I think that is because of this Revelation 12 sign. Have you heard about this? Do you know what's being said about this sign?
No.
Okay, so there's this teaching going around that next September, when this cosmic sign actually shows up, by the way, for the second time in history, that it is going to be a sign of the rapture. And I totally disagree with that, because it is not the sign of the pickup for a wedding ceremony, which is what the resurrection is. It's the people of God being gathered together for the marriage to the Lamb. That's not what the sign is about. The sign is about a pregnancy. So this has happened twice. And the first time it was back in 3 BC at the time of Yeshua's conception. And when I say Yeshua, I mean Jesus, by the way. It's just his Hebrew name. So in 3 BC, the sign that John was shown in Revelation 12 is this. It's a woman, a virgin, clothed with the sun, with the moon at her feet, and a crown of 12 stars. Now, you might read that and think, oh, he was just seeing a vision. But actually, he was looking into the second heaven, into the firmament, and he was seeing the constellation of Virgo. God actually wrote all of redemptive history into the sky as the Maseroth, or what we today call the Zodiac, and then the three deacons that go along with each one of the constellations, the zodiacal constellations. So there's a story there, and in this story, the virgin is right next to the lion, which is representative of Yeshua, the Lion of Judah. And so the story really ends there. It goes around the whole zodiac, and it ends where Virgo and Leo meet. Well, there was something fascinating that happened in 3 BC, where the planet Jupiter, the king planet, comes into the constellation of Leo, and it goes to Regulus, which is the king star. And every ancient culture was always considered the king star. And so the king planet aligns with the king star, and then it goes into what's called retrograde motion, so it slows down and it reverses course. And it goes back and forth in conjunction with Regulus three times. Basically, it traces out a halo over this star. That's pretty amazing. But at the same time that that was happening over a course of 9 months, which is the term of a pregnancy, right at the beginning of that 9 months, what we saw was this alignment. We saw Virgo with the new moon at her feet. The sun was right over the constellation. And at her head were the nine stars of Leo plus three wandering stars, making a crown of 12 stars. This alignment happened on the Day of Trumpets. So I said earlier, God has holy days throughout the year. They're prophetic mm-hmm. of things that happen in the redemptive plan. Well, this event happened, just so happened to be, on Yom Teruah, which is the Day of Trumpets, the day when the Israelites are blowing the trumpets and they're declaring this this season, this new season of atonement that we're entering into. So that's incredibly significant to me. And then 9 months later, after the coronation of Jupiter around Regulus completed, you had another thing happen. Jupiter moves over and aligns with Venus, and it created the brightest star that's ever been seen. In fact, they show it in observatories even today, in planetariums.
Yeah.
And this, to me, this is the Bethlehem star. And I got this idea from a lawyer turned astronomer named Rick Larson, or Frederick Larson. He does a really great presentation called The Star of Bethlehem. I recommend everybody check it out. But he identified this. Very interesting that that timing happened as it did, because then that means that Yeshua would have been born when the Star of Bethlehem showed up in July, not in December. However, the Magi, when they saw that star happen, they would have loaded up and headed from Persia over to Israel. And by the time they got there, it was December. And so it was December 25th, actually, when Jupiter again goes into retrograde right over Bethlehem, if you're looking at it from Jerusalem. And so they would have followed that down there to Bethlehem and seen Yeshua, who at the time would have been about 6 months old. So there's something to that date, December 25th. And to me, I'm thinking, well, why that date? Because I know that that date was the winter solstice, and it was right. The time when all of the ancient cultures worshipped the sun god dying. And then later on in the year, they would worship the rebirth of the sun, which is all, you know, figurative of what we've already talked about. Here we're
well,
coming
hold
up on
one
break,
more so second. We're up against a break. We'll take our final break and come back with the last segment right after this, folks. All right, last segment. So I want to get back to this date. You were explaining it in history. What does it mean in the future?
Okay, so something has already started on Christmas Day. Jupiter came into the womb of Virgo. Now, some people say it started earlier than that, but the planet didn't really slow down and go into retrograde motion until about December 25th, Christmas time, which is winter solstice, again, the day when people are worshiping the sun gods. And so for 9 months, it's going to be inside of Virgo, circling around. And then in September, early September, it exits out between her legs like it's being born. And then in December or September 23rd, the sign happens again, where the sun comes in to clothe Virgo, the moon is at her feet, and there's 12 stars over her head. But, this is not exactly the same, because the first time, it happened on the Day of Trumpets. This time, it won't. It's going to miss the Day of Trumpets by 1 or 2 days. Whether you're a conjunctionist or a sliverist, either way, it misses it. Also, the first time, Jupiter was crowning Regulus. So this time, Jupiter is going right into Virgo, and it's circling, and it comes into conjunction with Spica, the star Spica. And it happens after. So the timing is a little bit different, but it is very, very similar. And so this is interesting, because when we look in Revelation 12, the sign that John sees is both past and future. How do I know that? Well, it talks about the woman giving birth to this son who would redeem the nations and who would be caught up. He'll be, you know, taken to heaven and kept there. And that is talking, obviously, about Yeshua, the Messiah, who this child, who the serpent, the dragon tried to devour. He wasn't able to, because they ran away to Egypt, but then he was crucified later, and then he was snatched up to heaven after the resurrection. So that's the past, but then the vision keeps going, and it talks about things in the future. It says the dragon is enraged, and he goes after the woman. She is taken to the wilderness, and protected there for 3.5 years. He tries to send a flood at her, but the earth opens up to protect the woman, and then he's enraged, so he goes after the other ones, the offspring of the woman, who hold to the testimony of Yeshua and obey the commands of God. And then there's a war in heaven. So all this stuff is yet to come. The woman represents not just Mary, as some people would have us believe. She's figurative of messianics, of believing ethnic Israelites in general. These people in the future will be taken away to safety in the wilderness, and then the dragon comes after her other offspring, which are the Gentiles who have believed and have become part of Israel through their belief in Yeshua. And the war in heaven where he's cast down hasn't happened yet. So it's both past and future. So when I'm looking at this future sign, I'm seeing a dark reflection. I'm thinking, because the timing is not quite right, it looks real close, but it's not on, and God doesn't do things, you know, partially. He's always very precise. I think that this is the time when the false Messiah will show up, and God is giving us a sign of this. Hey, look, it's a repeat. There's an imposter coming. It looks the same, but it's not. He's the bad guy, so we need to be prepared for him to show up. I'm going to read you something that's going to absolutely blow your mind. So the Roman poet Virgil, in 37 BC, he foresaw the times that we're in right now, and he prophesied through these unclean spirits called the Muses. And by the Muses, he said that the return of the Virgin would bring about the reign of Saturn. Saturn is the planet of Satan. It's the god of darkness, cold, and chaos. And that is exactly, I think, what we're staring in the face today, a time of chaos before the New World Order arises. So he said, the return of the Virgin will bring about this time of chaos, but then there will be an arrival of a new generation sent down from heaven, and the birth of a boy in whom the golden race shall arise. This boy, he said, was Apollo, the sun god. And Virgin, his oracle indicates that this child will possess divinity. He'll be a demigod. He's going to see heroes mingled with gods, which I think is talking about transhumanism. And eventually he will rule over the entire world, which his father has brought to a state of peace. Well, who was the father of Apollo? It was Zeus. Zeus was the ruler of the gods who bore Apollo, and Zeus is Satan. So, and I can prove that. Not only was he often portrayed as a serpent in the ancient world, but in Revelation chapter 2, 13, Yeshua states that Pergamum, the city of Pergamum, is the place where Zeus has his greatest altar. Well, Pergamum at that time was where the great altar to Zeus existed, and that was what Yeshua said is the location of Satan's throne at that time. So Yeshua was linking Zeus with Satan, and of course the name of that god has changed over time. You know, before that it was El in Canaan, and before that it was, you know, Enki. But at that point, Zeus was basically Satan, and so this son of his, Apollo, is not a good guy. He's the son of the red dragon. He is Satan's seed. Now, I know Virgil is not a prophet of Yahweh, but if he was in communication with unclean spirits, and the devils understand the signs in the heavens and what those portend, if they can read the story that's in the Maseroth, then there's no reason that they wouldn't know what was going to happen, the timing, what would occur in the future. And so I think what he prophesied is probably very accurate. And we're looking at, right now, in this time that we're in, we're looking at the return of Apollo or Asher.
How will we be able to tell? I mean, is it going to be born as an infant and then we have to wait 30 years because he's going to be a false Messiah?
I think that's quite possible, that he will be brought about, that his reconstructed genetic material might be placed in a virgin, might have already been placed in a virgin, and that it is undergoing that process of growing right now and will be born in September. And then we'll have to wait for a while to see whether or not he shows up. It's also possible that he will be resurrected as an adult, and that the sign is not being fulfilled as literally as it was with Yeshua being conceived and growing up as a human child. But, you know, everything Satan does is a mimicry of things that God has done. And so I would suspect that he will bring his Messiah, his false Messiah, into the world as a baby and have him grow up in the normal way, because I think he's going to try and fulfill or pretend like he's the fulfillment of a lot of the prophecies in the scriptures about the Messiah. And the Jewish people, we're clearly told in Scripture, are going to be fooled by this. They're going to think that this guy is the Messiah, and they're going to enter into a covenant with him. And then later on, will be sorely displeased when he breaks that covenant and tramples them down, takes them away as slaves, and only then will the true Messiah show back up, and all of Israel will repent.
Do you think there's going to be like a Project Blue Beam false sort of rapture around this event too?
That's a good question. I haven't seen any proof. I haven't really researched it that deeply, but I haven't seen any proof that that kind of technology exists. But anything is possible, so it could be.
Okay. So overall, I mean, with about a minute and 50 seconds left to go, what do you want people to take away from the volume one of your series?
Life is, it's not random, and it's not just a bunch of events here on Earth. These things are being guided. There is an end goal. We need to be aware so that we're not deceived, because the Scripture says that the deception in the end times will be so severe that even the elect, if it were possible, would be deceived. So as the elect, we need to train ourselves up to understand the Scriptures rightly so that we're not deceived. By the way, the book is available as an ebook. You can go to leviathansruse.com if you want to get it that way. It's available as a paperback as well. But just so your listeners know, they can set their own price, because I want people to have this information. I feel like God told me, get it out there for free if necessary. And when you go to download the ebook in any format, you can set your own price. So if you can't afford it right now, that's okay. And I just ask you to, you know, read it, give it consideration, and learn something, and then, you know, maybe give me a good review or something, or talk about it. But it is there for free if you need it.
When is Volume 2 coming out, and what is it going to contain?
So we only got to, like, the first component of deception, but there's six components. Oh. The first three are in the first volume, so the second volume will tackle the second three components.
So wait. So you're saying there's two more elements that are in Volume 1 that we didn't even touch yet?
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, then you're going to have to come back, because I am just plumb out of time. Thank you so much for joining us. Everybody, grab the book, Leviathan's Ruse, Volume 1, The Comprehensive Guide to the Battle Between Good and Evil. Alexander Lawrence, thank you so much for joining us today, sir.
Thank you very much.
All right, folks, that does it for today. Remember, no victim, no crime. Look into jury nullification. Today, tomorrow, and as always, may your path lead to heaven, and may freedom follow in your footsteps.
Hey, thanks for watching. If you loved what I had to say, then subscribe right here. If you hated what I had to say, subscribe right here. It's fun being mad on social media, isn't it? Either way, I'd love to hear from you. Send me an email right there.